Let's ask God to help us to understand his word well today. Heavenly Father, as we consider your word this morning, we will see how in many ways we've fallen short of the glory of what you would have your church be. But we pray that you would challenge us, that you would deal gently with us, that you would re-enthuse us for your great universal project. And we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Well, again, here we are this morning, church, and I wonder why. Do you ever wonder why? I wonder why we're not perhaps still in bed, sleeping in under the warm covers. I wonder why we're not at home watching TV. I'm sure there's something good on. I wonder why we're not at Valentina's Cafe around the corner. I believe the brunch there on a Sunday is really good. I wonder why you're not washing the car or walking your dog or visiting family or playing golf. I wonder why you're not with the kids at Sunday sport. I wonder why you're not at Bunnings. That's where most people are. Maybe you are just churching here this morning because on your personal agenda there's nothing much better to do. I was talking to a young guy years ago. I still remember his words vividly. He was telling me about the church he was part of. They only actually met every second Sunday. He said, alternate weeks, oh, we just go somewhere else, look around, try other churches. I said, but what if everyone does that and they decide not to come back? And he said, oh, that happens all the time. Doesn't matter. He said, it's only church. Now, I wonder if for you, you're comfortable with the way those words run together, only church. I wonder if for you, meeting as a church is only an afterthought that fits in around anything else that's on. Because if you are comfortable with the words, it's only church, I want you to take a closer look this morning at Paul's words here in Ephesians chapter 3, where you'll notice that key word church is mentioned not once but twice, first in verse 10, then again the end of the chapter in verse 21. Did you notice? The word church in the original Greek is ecclesia, and it very literally means a gathering. It's not a religious word at all. It's a functional word for a get-together, gathering. The first Christians grabbed it as the most defining word of what they are, a gathering of the people of God. And as we saw, if you were here a couple of weeks ago, as we saw in chapter 1 and 2, a gathering of people from an incredible range of backgrounds, most uncommon at their time. You see, for us, in an age where if you happen to feel like a sermon, you can listen to the world's best preachers online whenever you like, sign up for their podcast. If you do, for some reason, feel like some community, there's always Facebook. I mean, actually gathering, it's just so inconvenient, isn't it? And in a world that offers so many other options on a Sunday morning, that maybe seems so much more promising in terms of networking, the people you can mix with, so much more impressive, and offer so much in terms of fun and maybe fitness and friendship for your kids. Options that seem to hold out the promise of such good times and such good coffee at Valentina's. You would have to be really persuaded, wouldn't you, of what we saw back in chapter 1 and 2. That we are in a world of no hope. We are in a world that's dead in sin, no matter what race you were born into, says Paul. A world where everyone's just pursuing what they most feel like and hurtling towards death and destruction. Until, as he reminded us, God has gathered people like us into his gathering, into his church, which is why Paul then says church is God's signpost of hope for the world. And in terms of our question through this series, who do you think you are, that is meant to be fundamental to our whole sense of identity. The starting point that we are first and foremost part of God's great gathering. Just notice his wording, first of all, in verse 10, that through the church, says Paul, the manifold wisdom of God may now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. Manifold meaning not the spare part for your car, but literally the word means multicoloured, multifaceted, like a jewel. The church is meant to be God's neon sign, not just to the people around us. Do you notice Paul's thinking much bigger than that? It's a neon sign to the universe, to all the spiritual forces there are. The church is the public cosmic advertisement of the wisdom of God. Or at least, that's the plan. Did you see the Bishop of Newcastle on the 7:30 report last week? So if you didn't see it, the Bishop of Newcastle was sharing the way he himself had been sexually abused as an altar boy by the then Bishop of Newcastle in a way that profoundly damaged him. And he was speaking with tears in his eyes. Now he is bishop himself, and he's determined that the sleazy secrets of the Anglican Diocese of Newcastle are going to be rooted out. That era is over. And instead of giving up on his faith, as many have, he's gone ahead with huge determination that the church should be what the church should be. I emailed him straight afterwards, or his office at least, and I said, good on you. Keep at it. Because something like that is so tragic for the people affected. And as well as that, a disaster when the world sees that stuff and sees that there's been a blind eye turned to it, because so much does the very opposite of what Paul's saying the church should be. Those perpetrators defacing, destroying not just young lives, but what is meant to be God's display of his glory to the world and beyond the world through the display of the love and unity of his people. And we've just got to be relentlessly reversing that perception the world's got with our relentless commitment to integrity and love and being what the church should be. Verse 20 and 21, take a look down the page. Paul's prayer is that God would be glorified in the church through all generations. That the church, in ways far richer than you could even ask or think, would bring the world to its knees in admiration of the God whose church it is. Let's follow his wording. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. That is, of course, unless you're doing something more pressing. That is, of course, unless you've got a better offer. That is, of course, unless you feel it's more important to follow your sexual urges in a way that destroys generations of kids. That is, of course, unless you're too busy chasing your own personal goals to care about being a church and what a church should be. That is, of course, unless you're too busy going to Bunnings. We are invited into God's great gathering as the start of renewing the world. We're called into a new unity that crosses all kinds of boundaries. We're called to be a living, breathing demonstration of how God wants to put the world back together. And so often we've just taken it for granted, as we miss the point that gathering together his church is God's beacon of glory to the universe. And can I say, while your own experience of church might have been a disappointment, and it always will be this side of eternity, while your experience of church might be of something slightly boring, while your experience of church might be of relationships that have been less than they could be and should be, while maybe you've been hurt in the past, can I ask you this morning just to try to catch a glimpse of God's great intentions and recommit and remember the times when you have caught a glimpse of that in all its beauty? Because God's plan, you see, is devastatingly simple, and it's disarmingly beautiful when you just catch a glimpse of it. You notice here in chapter 3, Paul's language is just bubbling with adjectives of greatness And so we'll talk about in verse 8 the unsearchable riches of Christ, or that word, the manifold wisdom that we've already seen in verse 10, the many-coloured rainbow of God's wisdom in the church. The glorious riches, he says, of the Father, verse 16, the love of God that surpasses knowledge, verse 19. Of course, they're all talking about the same thing, that plan of God to bring his church together under Christ from all different kinds of people in love for one another. Now, maybe that doesn't sound so great to you, but when you look at the rest of the world, let me tell you, it's fantastic. Think back to what we saw in Ephesians 1 and 2, that great inheritance, the great promises of God that the people of Israel had, the great hope of the coming king that the Jews held on to for generations. Paul says it has arrived at last in the coming of Jesus Christ, whose blood brings forgiveness of sins, whose resurrection brings the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. And the surprise is, he says, you Gentiles get to share it as well. We looked forward to it, now you get to enjoy it. So we saw, when we looked at it carefully, how Paul talked about us Jewish Christians on the one hand, who he called the saints, and then you Gentile Christians who get to share the hope, who get to share the inheritance. In all your diversity, he says, we're all alike together under the death penalty of sin, all alike together when we trust Jesus have been raised up with Christ, all together, being built together as one dwelling place of God's Spirit, in this thing called the church, the great gathering. Which, you see, as you come from chapter 1 and 2 into chapter 3, is exactly the idea that's flowing through everything he says. He says in a nutshell, this is why I'm praying that you actually will love each other. This is why I'm praying that the church will be that beacon of unity and hope and love. Now, when you look at chapter 3, the logic's kind of messy because Paul starts a thought and then he diverts. Did you notice that in the reading? He starts his main thought in verse 1 and then sidetracks to remind them what he's been saying. For this reason, he says, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus on behalf of you Gentiles. And then suddenly the detour, which doesn't get back on the main road till verse 14. Where he picks up his thought again. For this reason, he says again, I bow my knees before the Father. And then he goes on to his main point, which we'll see in a moment, and to talk about what he prays for on his knees. So we've got to kind of hold his train of thought while we travel around the detour and put it all together. So he's going to pick up his point at the end of chapter 2 and say, because you Jews and you Gentiles are being built together to be a dwelling God lives in by his Spirit, I'm going to pray that you work that out in practice. Again, I'm not sure we get the full impact of this. There's a sense that culturally we're moving back to a model of a kind of cultural suspicion. Yes, it's certainly very much there in Jerusalem these days. There's a wall, there's a huge wall with soldiers, security between Jerusalem and the Gentiles on the Gaza Strip. They built the wall in 1994. Jews and Gentiles divided. Donald Trump wants a wall too, to keep out the Mexicans. Canada wants a wall too, to keep out the Americans. We say we don't need a wall, as long as we can stop the boats. Paul says, in Christ, something incredible has happened. In Christ, the walls are down. That's the theory again. He says that's God's great plan. It's also the reason he's in prison, because to the Jews it wasn't something they were keen to hear. You might sympathise with the Jews at that point. But let me remind you, Paul's wall-breaking mission and message, it is the only reason that Gentiles like you and me find ourselves anywhere in God's family. And that's all because of what Paul calls the mystery that's no longer a mystery. It's all because of the plan that's finally come together. Just run your eye down through verse 2 to 13. This is the detour. And you'll see, he makes the same point over and over again, that the plan that wasn't known before is now abundantly clear, that the mystery that wasn't understood before is now made known. Just follow his words down. Verse 2, he says, I'm assuming you've heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me, the way God made me a steward of his message. How the mystery, verse 3, was made known to me by revelation, as I've written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which wasn't made known before, but now has been through the apostles and the prophets. What was a mystery, now crystal clear. And he says, my job's to talk about it, verse 7. Of this gospel, of this good news, I was made a servant to preach to the Gentiles, he says, the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things. And what's the mystery? Well, he spells it out absolutely simply in verse 6. The mystery is this. He says, the mystery is that the Gentiles, you and me, are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Which again sums up exactly what we saw in chapters 1 and 2, that people like us can join the family. Which again, you know, these days to you and me doesn't seem mysterious at all, because we just kind of think we deserve to be included. We're the default position. Until you remember, historically, you see, he's talking about crossing the biggest ethnic dividing wall there ever was. In a way, again, that created instant hostility in the culture Paul was part of. In Christ, he says, the walls are down. We were included then. How does it work for us now? How are we going at modelling that? As perhaps the culture around us gets more and more tense and hostile, as like aligns with like over overt things like race and colour and politics, are you ready to say brother, to say sister, across those lines in Christ? Paul says the mystery is this, that no matter where you came from, no matter what colour you are, no matter what your ethnic background, when you've put your faith in Jesus, you're all part of the same body. And the church, he says in verse 10, is meant to be the display of that. Full technicolour love. You see, there's nothing that Paul wants to see more and the Ephesians living out that reality. And so he comes back in verse 14 to the thing that he was starting to say at the beginning, the thing that he is most moved to pray. Here's where the detour's finished, back on the main train of thought. And as you come back to a long and complicated sentence that runs all the way from verse 14 to 19, so it's a little bit hard to follow. But in the end, it breaks down to a very simple prayer, a prayer to the Father who specialises in families, all kinds of families, that the Ephesian church might really be a family. A prayer that God, out of the riches of his glory, might do something amazing in them by his Spirit. A prayer that boils down in verse 17 to this. And remember, he's talking to a church made up of the saints, the Jewish Christians, and you Gentile Christians like us. He prays that Jesus may so fill their hearts that they will know what love really looks like. That's the essence of the prayer. I'm praying, says Paul, that you, middle of verse 17, I'm praying that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend, you Gentiles, you non-Jews, together with the Jewish saints, what is the breadth and length and height and depth, to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you'll somehow comprehend, he says, how inclusive the love of Christ has been to include even you. That the love of Christ encompasses all kinds of people. Do you really get that? The implications. Because our love, you see, so often doesn't. He says, I'm praying that you, having been planted in love, together in the church can catch on to how big the love of Jesus is and so be filled with the fullness of God. That when you catch on to the fact that Jesus loves not just people like you, but the people not like you, you might love that widely as well. Again, is it working? Because that's how the church becomes the great advertisement of God. Perhaps you saw in your growth group through the week a great little video of Lewis and Ricky. Now, there's an example. If you didn't see it, have a look when you go home. I've put the web address on your outline, and it's worth a look. Very different people. Very united in Christ. very different people. How deep and wide and broad is the love of Jesus? How's your love? We're still so easily tribal in our thinking, aren't we? Drawing lines. And you could almost do it literally, couldn't you? Who sits with who? Who won't sit with who else? Which family, which tribe, which generation? People who have been part of the church for 50 years, people who are new, people who vote the other way than you do, people who don't send their kids to the right kind of school. If those lines are still there for you, maybe it's because you haven't fully absorbed how big the love of Jesus is. In the video, Lewis says, we don't really have much in common apart from Christ. But that's the point. If you really catch on to the breadth and depth and height and width of the love of Christ, then you're unavoidably starting down the path of loving one another against the odds, across the generations, across the congregations, across cultural dividing lines, in a way that only astounds the world around us when they see the way we love one another. Not only that, but amazes the spiritual powers of the universe as well. Imagine that, heaven looking down on our church, marvelling at it, marvelling at the love, at the boundaries that the world tries to put up that just come down between us as we understand the sacrificial love of Jesus that took him to the cross and use that as our motivation to love one another. So why are you here this morning? Not home mowing the lawn. Why are you here this morning? Not enjoying coffee and toast and the Sunday paper. You are here to demonstrate to the universe that alienation and self-centeredness and hatred and division do not have the last word. You're here to work together to display that love in real ways to the world and beyond. There is work to do to make the reality measure up to the vision. But that's the challenge. And God is at work by his Spirit to do that. So can I say, at the very least, be here week by week to be part of God's gathering. Be part of it. Because, of course, church on a Sunday morning, it's just the beginning of what church is about. Look for ways to love people, to build bridges to anyone new, every way you can. Keep looking at the love of Jesus as you see it on the cross and look for ways to imitate that towards one another. It is a great reminder at the end of Paul's prayer, the verse we looked at already, that the potential for the church to be what it should be goes way beyond what we could even dream of. And that's what moves me, in a sense, thinking about our future at MPC. I mean, it's easy to be discouraged, isn't it, even as a Christian these days. Because we are so disappointed when we see the public failures of others, and we're scared as we see an old priest executed in his church in France, and we are intimidated when we're publicly accused of hate speech just because we're in favour of old-fashioned marriage. And on top of that, the biggest problem, we so easily get lukewarm just because we're so busy with other stuff. It's like the perfect storm. So who are you? That's the question we're asking through the series. How do you define yourself? How do you think of yourself in the deepest core of your being? If a loved and forgiven member of God's church is not right at the top of your list, if that's not right on the tip of your tongue, over and above a member of the garden club or a New Zealander or a Broncos supporter, I want to encourage you to lift your eyes a little higher. Because who you are is that you are a fundamental building block of something incredible that's being built together by God from all kinds of people as the most important family in the world, all under one Lord, Jesus Christ. Jayesh is going to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege of being loved and forgiven members of your church. and help us not to take this privilege for granted. Help us to come to church with grateful hearts and to sacrificially serve each other as we do. Help us to work together to display and demonstrate the love that you've shown us to each other and to the world. Please forgive us for the ways in which we've failed to do that well. Please change us. Please work in us by your Holy Spirit that we might be a united church that brings glory to your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.